Good morning, students. So today we are going to discuss properties of colloidal solutions. So few properties we are going to discuss, not all properties in this session. So one by one we are going to discuss. Now first of all, colligative properties. Now we have studied in solutions chapter that colligative properties are those properties which depend upon the number of molecules of solute and are independent of their nature. Okay, so when we talk about colloidal sol, then in case of colloidal sol, particle size is bigger as compared to normal solution. In case of normal solution, the size is less than 1 nanometer, whereas in case of colloidal sol, the particle size is from 1 nanometer to 1000 nanometer. Okay, so since the particle of colloid are formed by the aggregation of molecules, so it means total number of molecules, that number has been decreased in case of colloidal solution. So it means that colligative properties, when we will calculate for colloidal sol, the value obtained will be smaller as compared to the values shown by true solutions, because in case of true solution, particle size is small and particles do not aggregate. Okay, it can be understood just like association of molecules. Okay, now second and important effect is Tyndall effect. Tyndall is the name of scientist. He observed a phenomena of scattering of light by the colloidal sol or suspension particles. Okay, now this was possible because particle size in case of colloidal sol or suspension was large enough, and those particles were capable of scattering the light. Okay, now when we will be able to observe Tyndall effect, there are two conditions which must be met. Number one, the diameter of the dispersed particles is not much smaller than the wavelength of the light used. So whatever light we are using, that will have some wavelength value. Now that wavelength value, whatever light we are using, that and the particle size which are dispersed, they should not be very small. Okay, the value should not be small. Okay, only then they can scatter, otherwise scattering process will not occur. Next property is refractive index values of the dispersed phase and dispersion medium must differ by large amount. There must be large difference in the refractive indexes of dispersed phase and dispersion medium particles. Okay, so when we know about Tyndall effect, then where it is used, when we are given two solutions and we don't know which one is true solution, which one is colloidal, then we will check those two by the use of Tyndall effect. Okay, so when we are saying that scattering of light is observed, it means that path of light can be seen when light passes through colloidal sol or suspension. Okay, this is the meaning of scattering of light. Okay, now see here in this diagram, you can check this is the source of light and we are passing light through this colloidal sol. This is colloidal sol. Okay, now when we pass this, then this area is illuminated and we can see this as we can see the path of light. This will be visible to us if we see at the right angle. Okay, so it means that this particular solution is capable of scattering light. Okay, so this thing is called Tyndall effect. So in simple words, what we can say that when light passes through colloidal sol or suspension, then its path is visible. We can see from where it is moving. Okay, so because of this, we say that it is possible only because of scattering of light by the dispersed phase particles present in colloidal sole or in suspension. Okay. Now, third property is about color. So, color of the colloidal solution, it also depends on wavelength of light scattered by the dispersed particles. Okay. One thing is this, that what was the wavelength of light which was falling on the colloidal solution? On the basis of that, we will see a particular color. This is one thing. Second thing, the wavelength of light depends on the size and nature of particles. Okay. So, wavelength of light, what should be the wavelength of light which is being scattered? That depends on size and nature of the particles. Now, color of the colloidal solution also changes with the manner in which the observer receives the light. Now see, where observer is standing, which light he is receiving, from that particular angle also we have to see. Okay, if now see, let us check it with an example. A mixture of milk and water appears blue. Okay, it will look like blue if observer is viewing it by reflected light. Okay, and he will find it as red when he is viewing it by transmitted light. Okay, so it means when we pass light through a colloidal sole, then we are able to see some color also. Okay, this is one thing. Then at what angle we are seeing it, that also decides the color of light. Okay, in simple words, you can see like this. Now one more example is there. Finest gold sole. Finest gold sole means when particle size of gold is very, very small. Okay, in that case, we will see it as red. But with the increase in size of the particle, it will look like purple color, and then it will look like blue color, and finally it will look like golden color. Means with the increase in size of the gold particles, its color will change from red to purple, then purple to blue, then blue to golden. Okay, so what is the property now concerned? That colloidal sole particles, they when they scatter a light, then we are able to see certain color also. Okay, now next property is called Brownian movement. Now this is asked in this way, that what do you mean by Brownian movements? What is its cause? Okay, and what is its importance? Okay, now see, what is Brownian movement? First of all, let us see this thing. This is called zigzag motion of particles. This is called zigzag motion of particles. Now, this zigzag motion of particles is termed as Brownian movements. Okay, this is what Brownian movements are. Now, second thing comes, why we observe such movements. Now see what happens when we take a colloidal sole, then there are two types of particles. One is dispersed phase and another is dispersion medium. So what happens, dispersed phase particles strike with the dispersion medium particles, and the movement of particles is in the zigzag form. Okay, so dispersed phase particles will keep on colliding with dispersion medium molecules, and they will keep moving from one end to other end, and we will see this type of motion. Okay, and this motion is termed as Brownian movement. Now it comes, what is its importance? So it is important for the stability of collide. Now see, in case there are no Brownian movements, then what will happen? These molecules of dispersed phase may come together and they may settle down. Because of these Brownian movements, they are continuously in motion, and so the colloidal sole is stable. Okay, so this is the importance of Brownian movements. Now one more important property, charge on colloidal particles. This is very important. Whenever we take a particular collide, then there is some charge on the dispersed phase particles. Okay, that charge may be either positive or negative. Okay, now the question comes, that is this charge responsible for stability of collide? So yes, this development of charge or charge on the colloidal soul particles is responsible for the stability of colloid. Now how is it responsible? Now see, the presence of equal and similar charges on colloidal particles is largely responsible in providing stability to the colloidal solution, because the repulsive forces between charged particles having same charge prevent them from coalescing or aggregating when they come closer to one another. So what is the reason, what reason we have given? We said that because of the charge, when all the particles are carrying similar charge, then what will happen? Similar charges repel each other. So different colloidal particles, they will be repelled by one another, and this will prevent their coagulation, or this will prevent their aggregation, or this will prevent their coming closer and becoming a larger molecule and settling down. This process will stop. This process will never happen, because they are carrying same charge and similar charges will repel each other and the colloidal soul will be stable. Okay, now question comes that why there is development of charge, how this charge gets developed on the colloidal soul. Okay, now let us see, this is very important. The soul particles acquire positive or negative charge by preferential adsorption of positive or negative ions. This is the key word you have to remember. What to remember? Preferential adsorption of positive or negative ions. Now see, whenever there is formulation of colloidal soul, then what happens? Say just like if I talk about peptidization process, then what happens in peptidization process? We take particular precipitate and then we dissolve it in a particular electrolyte. Okay, that electrolyte contains either both the charges, both charged ions, positive ions also, negative ions also. Now out of these two ions, one ion will get adsorbed over molecules of precipitates. Okay, then suppose positive charge gets adsorbed, then it will become positive soul. In case negative charge gets adsorbed, then it becomes negative soul. Okay, now this thing, that out of these two, which ion is going to prefer to get adsorbed, that will decide the type of charge on the colloidal soul particles. Okay, so this is meaning by, this is the meaning of preferential adsorption of positive or negative ions. Okay, so let us explain this again. When two or more ions are present in the dispersion medium, preferential adsorption of the ion common to the colloidal particle usually takes place. So in most of the cases, what happens, whatever ion is common, that will get adsorbed. Okay, and whatever is the charge on that ion, that will be the charge on colloidal soul. Okay, now let us take two examples. In the very first example, we took highly diluted solution of silver nitrate, means what we took, AgNO3 aqueous, and what we added, we added highly diluted potassium iodide solution, means what we added, Ki. Now AgNO3 plus Ki, what will be the result? Result will be AgI. AgI will be formed, silver iodide will be formed. Okay, now since both things we have taken in a very diluted form, so in this case what is going to happen, at once silver iodide is formed, there will be adsorption process, and adsorption of iodide ion will take place, and that will get adsorbed, and since there is a negative charge on iodide ion, so it will carry negative charge and the soul will be turned as negative soul. Okay, now see, it will be represented like this. What does it mean? It means AgI was the colloidal soul, means it was the precipitate formed, and I negative ion get adsorbed over it, and so since negative ion has got adsorbed, so it is carrying negative charge. Similarly, in the second case, now let us discuss the second case. If we take a Ki solution, now it is just potassium iodide solution, it is not a very dilute solution. And we add it to the silver nitrate solution, it is also not very dilute. Okay, then what is going to happen? Again, we are going to get silver iodide, but in this case, what will be there? Positively charged sole will be formed. Why? Because when we have not taken a very dilute solution, then silver ion will get adsorbed. Okay, and we will represent it like this. Now, since silver ion has positive charge, so it will be positively charged sole. Okay, now let us take one more example. If FeCl3 is added to the excess of hot water, now see, two things we have to remember. One thing, excess, it is in excess and it is hot, then positively charged sole of hydrated ferric oxide is formed. Now see, this is hydrated ferric oxide and this is ferric ion. Okay, now ferric ion gets adsorbed in this case, so because of this we are going to get positively charged sole. Okay, now suppose ferric chloride is added to NaOH solution. Suppose we add ferric chloride to NaOH solution, then what is going to happen? Then again there will be formation of ferric oxide, but because of the presence of NaOH, OH negative ion will get adsorbed. Okay, now since OH negative ion is carrying negative charge, so this sole will be negatively charged sole. Okay, now when there is formation of when we are saying that there is development of positive or negative soles, then how do they exist and is there any theory which will decide the stability? So there is a theory. The theory is called electrical double layer theory. Okay, and this explains the stability of the colloidal sole. Now in electrical double layer theory, what we are saying, having acquired a positive or negative charge by selective adsorption on the surface of a colloid particle, as stated above, this layer attracts counter ions from the medium, forming a second layer. Okay, now see what we are saying. See, till now we have discussed this thing. What is this? This is the precipitate and this is the ion which is being adsorbed. These are the precipitates and this is the ion which is adsorbed on this. So in this case it is positive and here it is negative sole. Okay, now what we are saying, that since this particle is inside, or whatever is the total mixture, there this colloidal sole particles exist. Now there is presence of other ions also, means there is presence of positive as well as negative ions. So whatever is the charge on colloidal sole particles, it will attract the oppositely charged particles which are present in the same medium. Okay, so if it is negative sole, then it will attract the positively charged particles. If it is positive sole, then it will attract the negatively charged particles. Okay, now this thing makes two layers. Which two layers? See, when we talk about this thing, then I negative was also adsorbed, so it is the fixed layer, and this is being attracted by this whole molecule, so this is mobile layer. It is mobile layer. Mobile layer means it will keep on moving in the solution, though this will also move in the solution, but I negative will be fixed, it will get adsorbed, it will not come out. But K positive, it is mobile, it will not be fixed, but it will move freely. But when we are talking about I negative, that has adsorbed to AGI, and AGI will move along with I negative. So it is the permanent layer, whereas K positive is diffused layer. Okay, so these two layers will be there, and they are termed as double layer. Okay, now this was found by Helmholtz, so it is also called as Helmholtz electrical double layer. Okay, now one is fixed layer and another one is diffused layer. Okay, now since there is development of charges and opposite charges are there, so it means there will be development of potential. Okay, there will be development of potential. Now this potential difference between the fixed layer and the diffused layer of opposite charges is called electrokinetic potential or zeta potential. So sometimes we are asked question, what do you mean by zeta potential? So what is zeta potential? It is the potential difference between the fixed layer and diffused layer formed in the colloidal source solution. Okay, this way you can define it. Now let us see it with the diagram. Okay, now see here, this thing is our precipitate and this thing is our layer of those atoms which are getting adsorbed over it. Okay, these are adsorbed. Now this thing, this dotted line represents K positive particles. Now these ions are being attracted by negatively charged ions, so they are forming diffused layer. Now after the very first K positive, there will be presence of these all. Okay, so this whole thing collectively known as diffused layer. Okay, so these two layers, this one and this one, these two are, one is a fixed layer, another one is a mobile layer, because see, this can be replaced by this or this, or similarly this can be replaced by this or this. Okay, so these are mobile, they will be there, but which one is there, that will keep on changing. Okay, so it is mobile layer, and this one is fixed layer, this one is fixed layer. Okay, now difference in the potential between the two is called zeta potential. Okay, now let us read this also. If two particles of an insoluble material do not have double layer, okay, now see, let us suppose there is no double layer, then what will happen? Then they can come close enough and attractive van der Waals forces pull them together. Okay, so they can come nearer, and because of attractive forces they will come together. When particles possess double layer, the overall effect is that the particles repel each other at large distances of separation, and this repulsion prevents their close approach and they remain dispersed and collide is stabilized. So because of this electrical double layer formation, our collide is stable. Okay, now whatever we have discussed till now, you have to solve these home assignments. Okay, thank you.